Good morning to everybody. Yeah, today we will discuss. Yesterday we have started about the cholinergic system and the drugs which are cholinergic agonists and other thing. Today we will go ahead with the actual topic is concerned. I think you are all here. The cholinergic system and the drugs. So the cholinomimetic drug or cholinergic drugs are called as cholinomimetic agents, or they are also known as parasympathomimetic agents because they are mimicking the parasympathetic nervous system. And these drugs are called as the cholinomimetic because they are going to stimulate the cholinergic nerves or cholinomime or mimic the cholinergic system. And so these drugs which produce actions similar to that of the acetylcholine, that's why they are called as the cholinergic drugs. So either by directly interacting with cholinergic receptors, or they are also known as cholinergic agonists, or by increasing the availability of the acetylcholine at these sites, or they are also known as anticholinesterase drugs. So the classification of the cholinergic agonists first. So we know the conduction of the cholinergic system now at the action potential, the initiation of the action potential, then the junctional transmission, the role of the acetylcholinesterase, etc. So in this class, we are going to deal the drugs which are going to act on the cholinergic nervous system. So the acetylcholine is also a agonist which is going to act on the cholinergic nervous system. Apart from this one, the methanol and the other systems are also acting. Similarly, the alkaloids like muscarine, pilocarpine and many other drugs, they are the one which are going to act on the particular system, especially the cholinergic nervous system. So we can say that these drugs are cholinomimetic in nature. All these drugs are going to act on the cholinergic receptors and going to mimic the action of the cholinergic nervous system. Of course, the most of the drugs like the muscarine, the pilocarpine and arecoline. So muscarine is obtained from Amanita muscaria. Pilocarpine is obtained from the Pilocarpus jaburandi, and arecoline is from areca nut, that's areca catechu. So the muscarinic actions of these drugs, all the drugs, acetylcholine and other things, already we have dealt, but we will see the synthetic drugs, how they are going to act on heart. So the heart, acetylcholine hyperpolarizes the SC nodes. And all these are due to the M type of muscarinic type of the receptor. So as a result, rate of impulse generation is reduced. That is the bradycardia or even cardiac arrest may also occur. So at the AV node and his Purkinje fibers, refractory period is increased to conduction is slowed. Axonal conduction is slowed because of the more and more refractory period. So the PQR, the PR interval increases and partial to complete AV block may be produced. The force of atrial contraction is markedly reduced and the atrial fibers, the is also abbreviated. Resting membrane potential of atrial fibers is abbreviated. And due to the non-uniform vagal stimulation, the differential atrial fibers varies including the what you call as the inhomology and in predisposing to atrial fibrillation or flutter. Then the ventricular contractibility is also decreased, but the effect is not marked. All this type of the action is brought by the M2 subtype of the receptor, which is already learned by you in the previous classes. And the action of the cholinomimetic agents on the blood vessels, all blood vessels are dilated. So the action is due to the M3 type of the receptors. So they are all dilated through few, the skin, face, neck, salivary glands. So they receive the cholinergic innervation, and there is a fall in blood pressure and flushing. So especially the blush area occurs, and the M3 receptors are present on vascular endothelial cells, and the vasodilatation is primarily mediated through the release of a specific substance known as the endothelial derived relaxing factor, or also abbreviated as EDRF. And now it is very well known that EDRF is nitric oxide. So there are nitric oxide receptors are there, and these receptors are going to be activated and the relaxation or dilatation occurs. The phospholipase C and inositol triphosphate versus the diacylglycerol pathway. Diacylglycerol pathway activates endothelial nitric oxide synthase through the calcium calmodulin mechanism. And when the endothelium is damaged by disease, acetylcholine can diffuse to the vascular smooth muscle and cause vasoconstriction via M3 receptor located on the plasmid membrane. So these mechanisms are once again interrelated. So you have to go in deep, especially in these molecular mechanisms. Then what happens to the smooth muscles? Smooth muscle in most organs are contracted mainly through the M3 type of the receptors. So the tone and peristalsis in the gastrointestinal tract is increased, and sphincters relax abdominal cramps and evacuation of the bowels. And peristalsis in ureter is increased, and almost all the smooth muscles of the gastrointestinal tract, it is going to increase the contraction of the smooth muscles. Contraction of the smooth muscles is increased to a greater extent. Then the detrusor muscle, especially detrusor muscle, and the contracts, detrusor muscle of the bladder contracts while the bladder is trigone, and sphincter relaxes voiding the bladder especially, and the bronchial muscles constrict. Asthmatics are highly sensitive for bronchospasms, and dyspnea, precipitation of attack of the bronchial asthma, is very common. That's why the persons who are chewing the betel nut or areca nut, if they do have the asthma, and bronchoconstriction will be greatly, it is going to increase. That's why they should be careful while consuming the areca nuts, because it's going to cause the bronchial constriction. And the glands, especially most of the glands, all parasympathetic innervated glands are increased via the secretion, and activity will be increased by M3 and some M2 receptor. Just like sweating, salivation, lacrimation, increased tracheobronchial and gastric secretion, all these are increased through M2 and M3 type of the receptor. And the effect on pancreatic and intestinal gland is not markedly, it is going to increase. Whereas the secretion of milk and bile is not affected. That's also please note down. Whenever you administer any cholinomimetic agents, milk yield is not increased, or the glands are not contracted. And contraction of the eye or iris, there is meiosis, means constriction of the pupil. And this is brought out by the contraction of the ciliary muscles of the eye, and spasms of accommodation, increased overflow of flaccidity, reduction in intraocular tension, especially in glaucomatous patients. So there is always, they are going to increase the tension, and glaucoma is going to be increased and worsened. Then the nicotinic actions, these are all the muscarinic actions, whatever we have dealt, these actions are brought about by M1 to M3 receptors, and also M5 type of the receptors. And nicotinic type of the actions, autonomic ganglia, the receptors are present in autonomic ganglia and the central nervous system, and also the skeletal muscles. And autonomic ganglia, both sympathetic and parasympathetic ganglia, are going to be stimulated. And this effect is manifested at higher doses. Higher doses, especially the high doses of the cholinomimetic agents. And high doses of acetylcholine given after atropine causes tachycardia, because the receptors are going to be blocked and the tachycardia occurs. And rise in blood pressure due to stimulation of sympathetic ganglia and release of the catecholamines. So the whenever you administer the cholinomimetic agent, there is rise in BP. Is due to the sympathetic ganglia, which is going to secrete the norepinephrine and release of the catecholamine. So what happens on the skeletal muscles? The ionophoretic application of acetylcholine to muscle and plate causes the contraction of the fiber, especially the muscle fiber. The contraction occurs, and the intra-arterial injection of high dose can cause the twitching and fasciculations. It's going to cause such actions. And IV injection is generally without any effect due to rapid hydrolysis of the acetylcholine. So acetylcholine esterase is present in the junction of every cholinergic neuron, and whenever the acetylcholine is in excess with that of the acetylcholine esterase, it is going to be very fastly destroyed, whereas the norepinephrine is not like that. And another action, especially the nicotinic central nervous system action, is whenever the acetylcholine is injected IV, it is not going to penetrate the blood-brain barrier. Especially the acetylcholine is not going to, the exogenous administration of acetylcholine is not effective on the central nervous system. Please remember this thing, because it is not going to cross the blood-brain barrier. However, direct action into the brain produces arousal responses followed by the depression. And the uses of the cholinomimetic agents are the choline esters are rarely, and if ever clinically, they are used. And acetylcholine is not used because the evanescent and non-selective actions, because it is going to act on both the N type of the receptors and muscarinics. Both are present in the central nervous system. And methacholine was occasionally used to terminate the paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia, which is mediated from central nervous system, but it is not at all used nowadays. And bethanicol has been used post-operative or postpartum non-obstructive urinary retention. Bethanicol, once upon a time it was used, but because of the neurogenic bladder, especially the bladder which has lost the control of the autonomic nervous system, it is known as the neurogenic bladder, to promote the urination. In such condition, bethanicol. So it was used, and it can afford symptomatic relief in congenital megacolon and the gastroesophageal reflux disease, or it's also known as GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, or the hyperacidity syndromes. And another thing is the, especially the megacolon means the colon is becoming going to unresponsive to the regular sympathetic and parasympathetic stimuli, and becomes the mega means it is, the size will be increased to a greater extent, and the digestive system is impaired. And in such condition, the bethanicol was used once upon a time. But there are a lot of side effects are present, like belching and means a discomfort of the stomach, colic, involuntary urination, the defecation, flushing, sweating, fall in BP, and bronchospasm is going to occur. And dose is 10 to 40 milligram oral and 2.5 to 5 milligram subcutaneous, especially the bethanicol and other drugs. And polynomimetic alkaloids are there. Varieties of the alkaloids are obtained from the plant sources. So the first one is the pilocarpene. Pilocarpene is obtained from the leaves of Pilocarpus microphyllus, and Pilocarpus jabrandi is another variety. And many Pilocarpus plants do contain the pilocarpene as ingredients. So it has prominent muscarinic action, especially the pilocarpene, and also stimulates the ganglia and has got the nicotinic action, and mainly through the ganglionic muscarinic receptors. So in ganglia, both type of the receptors are there, muscarinic and nicotinic. So the action is initiated by the ganglionic muscarinic type of the receptors, and the small doses generally cause fall in blood pressure, because it is the muscarinic in action. They fall in the blood pressure because it is going to act on the heart and going to decrease the heart rate, and because of this thing there is decrease in the blood pressure. And higher doses elicit rise in blood pressure and tachycardia, which is due to the ganglionic stimulation through ganglionic muscarinic receptors. So it's very, very interesting that, see, if small doses, it's going to cause one action. In the larger doses, it is going to reverse the action of the same. And whenever the pilocarpene is applied on the eye, it penetrates the cornea and promptly causes the meiosis, M-I-O-S-I-S, or the pupillary constriction, and ciliary muscle contraction and fall in intraocular tension in the 4 to 8 hours. That's why the pilocarpene is applied especially on the eye for whenever its meiosis is required, whereas the pilocarpene is used only in the eye as 0.5 to 4% drops, not injected or anything. Directly it is instilled on the eye for the purpose. And it is the third line drug in the glaucoma, open angle glaucoma, wide angle glaucoma, and so many glaucoma are there. So it's the not the first drug of choice, especially in the glaucoma. It is the third line of the drug, especially in the open angle glaucoma. The initial stinging sensation or tingling sensation in eye and painful spasm of accommodation are frequent side effects of this pilocarpene. The other uses as the mitotic are the counteract mydriatics after they have been used for testing refraction. So, and to prevent break adhesions of the iris with lens or cornea by altering its mydriasis. So, whenever there is an overdose of certain drugs which are going to cause the mydriasis, then to reverse the action of these drugs, the pilocarpene is used. And whenever there is adhesion in between the, what do you call as, the lens and cornea, there is a situation, and if this going drug is used, then it will be useful. And it's a xylagogue, means increase the salivary rate, but no oral preparation is available. And the pilocarpene is available as 1%, 2%, 4% eye drops, as carpine eye drops, and also pilo drops, 2% eye drops, it's available. And the muscarine, especially, so muscarine is another drug by which the name muscarinic receptors were come because of the effort of Sir Henry Dale. He isolated this muscarine from Amanita muscaria and inosyme species of the mushrooms. So muscarine is present in Amanita muscaria and inosyme, Amanita and inosyme species of the drugs, and inosyme species, and has only, it is not muscarinic actions, muscarine, that's why the name muscarine. So it is not used therapeutically because it is having lot of toxicities, muscarine, just for the diagnostic purpose and characterization of the receptor purpose. It is used not for the therapeutic purpose to a greater extent. And the mushroom poisoning is one of the most common poisoning that's happening in case of the, if you persons consume certain varieties of the mushroom, it's going to cause it because of the toxic principle present in the particular species. And last three types of the mushroom poisoning is known, like there are varieties of the mushroom poisoning is known. The three types, at least three types of the mushroom poisonings are very well defined. Especially the number one is muscarine type, or it's also known as early mushroom poisoning. Number one is called as the early mushroom poisoning due to the inosine and related species of the mushrooms, especially inosine. So this is happening very commonly if the persons do not identify the mushrooms properly and eat them. So please be careful while you are going to eat the mushrooms, and many of you may eat the mushroom manchuris many times. So if it is wrongly identified as the regular edible mushrooms to that of the inosine species, then definitely it's going to cause the mushroom toxicity. And the symptoms characteristic of muscarinic actions appear within an hour of eating the mushroom and promptly reversed by atropine, because atropine is a specific antidote which is acting on all M type of the receptors, M1, M2, M3, M4 and M5 type of the receptor. And the second mushroom poisoning is of the hallucinogenic type, and this is due to the muscimol and other isoxazole compounds which are present in Amanita muscaria and related mushrooms in the larger quantities and rather than the muscarine. So hallucinogenic effect is due to the muscimol and isoxazole are the two compounds which are derived from Amanita muscaria. So it causes the muscarinic the hallucinogenic effect. These compounds activate amino acid receptors, especially GABA and glycine receptors, and block muscarinic receptors in the brain and have hallucinogenic property. And this manifestation of poisoning are primarily, they are centrally mediated, means it is going to act on the central nervous system, and the receptors, especially which are present in the brain, muscarinic receptors, they are going to be acted by this particular drug. And there is no specific treatment, and atropine is contraindicated in hallucinogenic type. See, because atropine is going to aggravate, because it is not an antidote for this particular poisoning is called. And psilocybe mexicana is a mushroom whose principle is psilocybin. Psilo, P is silent here, psilocybin is a tryptaminergic compound. So there is a different mechanism are there. And the third one is the pelodine type, or the pelodine type of the mushroom poisoning. It's also known as the late mushroom poisoning. So it is also a late mushroom poisoning. Delayed activity of this particular poisoning is there. After consumption of the Amanita phalloides and Galerina are related species, and these inhibit the RNA and both protein synthesis. And the symptoms start after many hours and are due to the damage to the GI tract and mucosa, liver and kidney. So this is phalloidine type, because the phalloidine is the toxic substance, and the treatment consists of supportive treatment. I will not go into the detail about this particular toxicity, and in the course the toxicology, then we can learn about all these toxicities. And the treatment is the thioactic acid, means has some antidotal effect. It's also important. And another drug is known as the arecoline, is found from the betel nut or areca cataceu, and has muscarinic as well as the nicotinic actions, and including those skeletal muscle end plates. So there is the skeletal muscle end plate, and arecoline hydrochloride is one of the drug. Arecoline hydrochloride is one of the drug which was once upon a time used as a tineoidal or the antecystodal drug because it used to cause the peristalsis by stimulation of the intestinal smooth muscles and evacuate the cystodes, and it was also having some action on the cystodes and used to cause the paralysis of the cystodes and the antecystodal drug. But nowadays, because of the modern drugs like the praziquantel, which are very specific to the worms are considered and less effect on the host. So the arecolin has got the CNS effect. So you are going to eat the pan parag and many other areca containing things, areca catechu and areca betel nuts has been tried in dementia as an enhancer of cognitive functions, but not found to be useful. And it is tried, so many drugs are tried, but has no therapeutic use. Arecolin has not got any therapeutic or the medical use, whereas the betel nut is very commonly a commercial crop of many countries, including India is one of the biggest producer of the areca nut. Of course, the Western Ghats and also the Davanagere, the Shivamogga district part, upper Ghats of the district. So, lot of areca is produced and from this arecolin. Please remember areca nut in areca nut garden and the arecolin. Arecolin has not got any therapeutic effect, but it also acts central the CNS and on the central nervous system, and also the peripheral activity is present. And now we will deal about the anticholine esterase property, anticholine esterase. Then, so anticholine esterase are the agent which inhibit choline esterases product acetylcholine from the hydrolysis. So these are known as the anticholine esterase agent. They are also the cholinomimetic agent, but the action is due to the inhibition of acetylcholine esterases. So these produce cholinergic effect in vivo. In vivo means inside the body, and potentiate acetylcholine in vivo and in vitro both. And some anticholine esterases have been additional effect on the nicotinic type of the receptor, or else many of the action is brought about by the muscarinic type of the receptor stimulation. And here we can find two type of the agents. One is the reversible agent and another one is the irreversible agent. So some agents are binding with that of the acetylcholine esterase reversibly, and these are called as the reversible agents, whereas some agents like this OPC and other compounds, they will act irreversibly. Whereas the reversible agents examples are many examples. Please remember the physostigmine or eserin, and the neostigmine, pyridostigmine, adrofonium, and rivastigmine, donepezil, and galantamine are the carbamates. This is the carbamate category of the anticholine esterase. Whereas some of them are the insecticides also, and the acridine compounds are tacrine is the acridine compound. Whereas the irreversible agents are two type of the compounds. Once again, the OPCs and some of the carbamates are irreversible acetylcholine esterase inhibiting agents, or diisofluoryl phosphate or difluos is one of the important organophosphorus compound which is going to irreversibly block the acetylcholine esterase enzyme. And icotiopate, the malathion or diazinon, a famous TIC20 is there, and tabun, sarin and soman, these are the nerve gases, especially they are used in the Second World War. And the above one, especially malathion, DFP, ecotiopate, these are the what you call as the insecticides. They are the insecticides. And the carbaryl and profoxur are carbamates class, whereas the bagon and savin, all these are the carbamates. And these are all insecticides. They are very potent agents and highly toxic agents, especially the OPC compounds and the carbamates. whereas the reversible carbamates are less toxic, whereas the irreversible carbamates are highly toxic. And here you can see now the very preliminary structure of the carbamates and OPC. In most of the organophosphorus compound, the phosphorus moiety is there with the three chains R1, R2 and R3. Whereas the phosphorus moiety, it makes whether the compound is reversible or irreversible, inhibiting agent of anticholine, acetylcholine, esterase agents. And all these anticholine esterase react with the enzyme acetylcholine esterase and act very similar to that of the acetylcholine, or they are the cholinomimetic agents. The carbamates and phosphates, respectively carbamylate and phosphorylate, the esterotic site of the enzyme. So as you know very well that the enzyme acetylcholine esterase got this anionic site and esterotic site, and both of these are going to bind with esterotic site, and sometimes reversibly and sometimes irreversibly. The mammalian anticholine esterase has been cloned, and details of its structure as well as mode of the action with that of the acetylcholine and anticholine esterases have been already, they are studied in very depth. The active region of acetylcholine esterase forms a complex which contains anionic site and esterotic sites. Two sites of the enzymes are there, and the hydrolysis of the acetylcholine involves the electrostatic attraction of positively charged N plus of the acetylcholine to anionic site, then nucleophilic attack by serine and OH moiety, which is activated by adjacent histidine, leading to acetylation of the serine. So because of this thing, the acetylcholine gets activated. The acetylated enzyme, the enzyme acetylcholine esterase is becoming acetylated, reacts with water to produce acetic acid and choline. That's how it is going to cause the metabolism of the acetylcholine, the potent neurotransmitter of the cholinergic nervous system. And this is a schematic diagram representation of the reaction of acetylcholine of the carbamate and anticholine esterase, whereas the E and F are noted here. Carbamylated, there is a lot of difference between the carbamylation and this phosphorylation. Phosphorylation is irreversible, whereas the carbamylation is reversible. And it is going to act with that of the choline esterase enzyme, acetylcholine esterase, and reactivation of phospholipated enzyme by the serine, histidine, and glutamic acid. So you can see that the enzyme has got two sites. One is the anionic site and esterotic site. Whereas the acetylcholine enzyme will get the complex with that of the acetic acid and choline. Then the acetylated enzyme rapidly it's activated or it is metabolizing the acetylcholine into acetic acid, and the free enzyme is free acetylcholine esterase. Whereas, especially in case of certain carbamate compounds, it is going to bind with that of the free enzyme, bind with that, especially the carbamylated enzyme is completely going to release the substituted carbamic acid and free enzyme is released. Whereas, the phosphorylated enzyme is not free, it is going to irreversibly block the what you call as the this anticholine esterase enzyme, and whereas the oxymes, pyrrolidoxime, ubidoxime, and many oxymes are going to activate this inactivated enzyme. So many times if the enzyme is inhibited for prolonged time, then aging becomes. So that you can see in this particular diagrammatic representation. And pharmacological actions of inhibition of acetylcholine esterase causes due to the amplification of endogenously released acetylcholine. So we are not going to administer any exogenous acetylcholine, but endogenously released acetylcholine will be released. This enhanced action or the amplification, because acetylcholine esterase or anticholinesterase is a very specific enzyme going to bind with that of the acetylcholine and going to cause or destroy the acetylcholine into acetic acid and the choline. Whereas the choline is uptaken into the presynaptic terminal, whereas they are qualitatively similar to those of directly acting cholinoreceptor stimulants, especially the anticholinesterase. Anticholinesterase activity is very similar to that of the cholinergic stimulators. And many times the lipid soluble agents like physostigmine and OPCs, physostigmine among carbamates and OPC, and all OPCs are usually lipid soluble, have more marked muscarinic and central nervous system effects and stimulate ganglia, but action on skeletal muscle is less dominant. So usually they are going to stimulate the ganglia, where in which both muscarinic and the nicotinic type of the receptors are there and going to stimulate. And because of this thing, the marked effect on the skeletal muscle, direct action on the muscle and flate cholinoreceptors as well stimulate the ganglia, but muscarinic effects are less prominent even though it's going to act on the muscarinic receptors. And as other thing, they do not penetrate the central nervous system and have no central effect, especially the drugs. And the ganglia, local hydrolysis of the acetylcholine esterase is less important in ganglia. Inactivation occurs partially by diffusion and hydrolysis in case of the plasma. But muscarinic effects are less prominent and they do not penetrate the central nervous system and have not got any central effect, whereas the ganglionic effects are very much prominent. And anticholinesterase agents stimulates ganglia primarily through the muscarinic receptors present there, and high doses causes persistent depolarization of the ganglionic nicotinic receptors and blockade of the transmission. Whereas the cardiovascular effects are very similar to that of the administration of cholinomimetic agents, but it's a little bit complex when compared to those agents. And muscarinic action would produce bradycardia and hypotension as usual through muscarinic receptor, whereas the ganglionic stimulation would tend to increase the heart rate and BP due to the involvement of the adrenergic nervous system. And thus the overall effects are often unpredictable and depend on the agent and its dosage. So after treatment with anticholinesterases, the acetylcholine released by a single nerve impulse is not immediately, it is destroyed. And the force of contraction, especially of the skeletal muscles, impartially curerized, and myasthenic muscles is increased. That's how the thing, especially the effect of the anticholinesterase drugs on skeletal muscles. So in the higher doses, suppose the toxicity of the OPC compounds, then it is persisted for depolarization for prolonged period, resulting in blockade of direct action of the neostigmine and its congeners at the muscle, and this result in augmentation of the all these features, and the neurotransmission of the neuromuscular junction, it is causing weakness and paralysis. It is going to inhibit. And the central nervous system, lipophilic anticholinesterases, which penetrate into brain, produce generalized alerting response, whereas the cognitive functions, especially of the brain, may be improved in Alzheimer's disease. So Alzheimer's disease is a one, there is a dementia or loss of memory will be present. And however, higher doses produce the excitement and mental confusion, disorientation, tremors and convulsions followed by coma. And coming to the pharmacokinetic of these agents, the first one, Very simply, I am going to explain it within one or two words. Otherwise, if you read the Goodman, Gilman and other thing, you will get a huge explanation. For a undergraduate, I think you have to know one or two lines. How physostigmine is absorbed from GI tract and parenteral sites. It is going to rapidly absorb from GIT and parenteral sites. And it is applied to the eye and it penetrates the cornea freely. Then it crosses the blood-brain barrier and is disposed after the hydrolysis of cholinesterase. That's one of the important action. Whereas the neostigmine and congeners, there the all this neostigmine, physostigmine and organophosphorus are belonging to anticholinesterase agents. Whereas the neostigmine and congeners are poorly absorbed orally, and the oral doses were 20 to 30 times higher than the parenteral dose. Usually it's always like that. Then they do not effectively penetrate into cornea or cross the blood-brain barrier. Whereas the physostigmine crosses the blood-brain barrier. And they are partially hydrolyzed and partially excreted unchanged in the urine. This is a very short pharmacokinetic parameter of the agent. And OPC compounds are absorbed from all sites, including the skin and lungs. So please see that the organophosphorus compounds, especially the malathion, parathion, sumathion, and monocrotophos, etc., all these are the organophosphorus compounds. Any compound ending with phos, like monocrotophos, dicrotophos, malathion, sumathion, parathion, all are organophosphorus compounds. And whenever these drugs are spilled on the skin, they are going to be absorbed into the circulation to very high quantity. So the toxicity is caused, and they are hydrolyzed as well as oxidized in the body and little is excreted unchanged in the urine. So this is the kinetic. Means why it is important to know the kinetic is, suppose the organophosphorus compounds, you have to get remove the toxicity. Means you have, if the organophosphorus compound is spilled on your skin also, it is going to penetrate from the skin's this site. And if you inhale the particular compounds and through the lungs, it is going to be absorbed. That's why whenever these pesticides are being sprayed, you will get giddiness and some polynomimetic reactions are also obtained. So be little careful or while handling such type of the agents, especially the anticholinesterase OPC compounds. And comparative features of the physostigmine and the neostigmine is like that. The source of the physostigmine and neostigmine, the source of the physostigmine is natural alkaloid from Physostigma venenosum, or it's also known as calabar bean, whereas neostigmine is a synthetic agent. The chemistry is the tertiary amine sensitive derivatives, whereas the neostigmine is a quaternary ammonium compound. That's why orally they are not so well absorbed. And the CNS actions are present to the physostigmine, whereas it is absent in case of the neostigmine. And the applied to the eye, what happens? The penetrates the cornea, whereas the neostigmine is not penetrating properly. Whereas the direct action on the nicotinic muscarinic cholinomimetic agents are absent. Not nicotinic muscarinic, neuromuscular blocking agents and present in case of the neostigmine. And the prominent effect on autonomic effector, whereas the prominent effect of neostigmine is on the skeletal muscles. So the important uses of the physostigmine, it's a meiotic nature, or glaucoma, it is a useful agent. And the dose, especially the neostigmine, is useful in the myasthenia gravis. I am going to tell what is a myasthenia gravis in future. The dose is 0.5 to 1 milligram. That oral and parenteral, it is the dose is the same 0.5 to 2.5 milligram subcutaneous of the synthetic agents. Duration of action of the physostigmine is 4 to 6 hours, whereas it is 3 to 4 hours in case of the neostigmine. And physostigmine eye drops are very commonly used and prepared freshly in the ophthalmological preparations, whereas the pyridostigmine resembles neostigmine in all the responses, but the dose is dose to dose less potent than the longer acting, and less frequent dosing is required, especially in case of the myasthenia gravis. And embononium is another drug which is belonging to the same category, long acting congener used in the myasthenia. And adrofonium resembles neostigmine in action, has a brief duration, and suitable only for diagnostic agents of the myasthenia gravis. Adrofonium, especially, it's using in case of myasthenia gravis, in which the antibodies are developed against the receptors. And tacrin is a lipophilic acridine dye compound which interacts with acetylcholinesterase in the manner analogous to the adrofonium. And the tacrin crosses the blood-brain barrier and has got a longer duration of action. That's why by increasing the brain acetylcholine levels, it was found to produce some symptomatic improvement in Alzheimer's disease, wherein which there is dementia or loss of memory will be there, especially in the geriatric patients. But it is having a lot of hepatotoxicity, and any drug which is having some effect on the desired effect, many times it will have more and more the untoward or undesired effects. And rivastigmine is another drug, lipophilic, related drug, and it's also a cholinesterase inhibitor. So this rivastigmine is also used in case of the Alzheimer's disease. And donepezil, as we have listed earlier, it is another centrally acting anticholinesterase that has produced cognitive and behavioral improvement in the Alzheimer's disease. So it is long acting and suitable for once daily administration, because most of the other drugs, they require the twice daily or thrice daily administration. And galantamine is the natural alkaloid inhibitor of cerebral anticholinesterase, in addition to weak agonistic action on the nicotinic type of the receptor, especially in the neurons. It is being used for the symptomatic relief of the Alzheimer's disease. And difluos or diisoflurane phosphate, it's a very potent and long-acting anticholinesterase agent. So it is a highly toxic agent, so it is obsolete. And icothiopate is an OPC compound, but it's having quaternary structure, it's water soluble, and was used as a long-acting meiotic. And precautions, the anticholinesterases are contraindicated in sick animals because of the AV conduction defects and hypotensive states. So these should not be used, and they are to be used very cautiously in people with peptic ulcers, asthma, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and seizures patients. So many times we are going to use them in the Alzheimer's disease and other conditions, but in certain conditions they are highly contraindicated. But the margin of safety of these agents is very, very low. That's why they are highly toxic, and one should not use them unless it's very much required. And uses of these agents as a meiotic, especially in case of glaucoma, it's used. Meiotics increase the tone of the ciliary muscle attached to the scleral spur and sphincter pupillae, which pull on and somehow improve alignment of the trabeculae, so that outflow facility is increased, so that the contraction occurs and glaucoma is reduced. And pilocarpine is the preferred meiotic, and the action is rapid and long lasting, 4 to hours and 6 hours to 8 hourly instillation is required. And even it can also be used to induce and may fluctuate in the between. and diminishing vision, especially in dim light due to the constricted pupil, the spasm of accommodation, and brow pain has been frequent side effects. And systemic effects are nausea, diarrhea, sweating, bronchospasm may occur with higher concentration of the eye drops also, because it is absorbed into circulation and cause all those side effects. And the physostigmine used only to supplement the pilocarpine. And miotics are now third choices of the drugs used for the treatment. And however, they are effective especially in case of glaucoma. And pilocarpine is a drug to close the glaucoma in the angle closure glaucoma. So to reverse the effect of the mydriasis after refraction testing and prevention of formation of adhesions between the iris and lens, as we have already discussed, the lens and iris get adhesions, and to medically deal with this condition, the pilocarpine is used. So especially it is especially the iritis, cornea under field condition, it's alternated with a mydriatic used. And now we will discuss an important disease known as the myasthenia gravis. So I put the photo of the Amitabh Bachchan because he was the person affected with the myasthenia gravis but recovered after the long term treatment. So this is an autoimmune disorder affecting about 1 in 10,000 population, and he was the one of the culprit of the myasthenia gravis. As indications, MYA, Maya means muscle, and it is due to the development of antibodies directed to the nicotinic receptor at the muscle end plate. So the antibodies are developed against the receptor itself. So the acetylcholine cannot act on the muscles, and there will be reduction in number of free nicotinic muscarinic cholinoreceptors, or the muscle cholinoreceptor to 1/3 of normal or less, and structural damage to the neuromuscular junction occurs. And this results in weakness and easily fatigability or repeated activity. And Big B, or the Amitabh Bachchan, he suffered a lot from the myasthenia gravis, which occurred during the film shooting of the Coolie film. And the eyelid, external ocular, facial and pharyngeal muscles are generally involved very fast, and later limb and respiratory muscles get affected. This is the pattern of this myasthenia gravis, and we will see what are all the clinical signs of this myasthenia gravis. So what happens here, the motor nerve end plate, the population of nicotinic receptors available at the muscle end plate for binding with that of the acetylcholine is markedly reduced due to their obliteration by nicotinic receptor antibodies. See here, where the action potential arises in the cholinergic nerves very near to the neuromuscular end plate, whereas it is going to be released, exocytosis occurs, then the acetylcholine is released. But instead of the receptors, freely available receptors, the antibodies are developed, and the antibodies will be bounded to receptor prior to the occupation of acetylcholine. So please see that the antibodies developed against the receptors, especially the acetylcholine receptors, will make the acetylcholine not to act on the particular type of the receptor. So acetylcholine esterase molecules located strategically at the muscle end plate rapidly hydrolyze the acetylcholine. So the acetylcholine cannot stay here for a long time, so it is getting destroyed by the acetylcholine esterases. And acetylcholine esterases inhibit acetylcholine esterase, allowing the same acetylcholine molecules to repeatedly interact with the available the nicotinic receptors, and frequency of acetylcholine and nicotinic interaction is increased. That's why so many times it is going to cause the what is called as the weakness of the muscles, especially weakness of the skeletal muscles only. And here also we can see that in a normal case, the neuron is especially supplying to that of the muscle is going to secrete the acetylcholine, it's going to open the sodium channel and going to cause the contraction of the skeletal muscle. Whereas in case of myasthenia gravis, the receptors are already blocked by the antibodies and hence the acetylcholine cannot act and no muscle contraction is obtained. And here also in the synaptic cleft, you can see that synaptic vesicles, they are going to fuse together and going to cause the exocytosis of the acetylcholine, but the receptors which are present on the post synaptic membranes or the muscle, this is a skeletal muscles, they will have the antibodies already preformed antibodies and the acetylcholine cannot act on the muscle fiber. That's how the mechanism is explained. And here also you can see that the action potential arises, then the calcium entry occurs, then exocytosis is there. In the normal what you call as the cell, the receptors will be activated with the action of the acetylcholine, and then what you call as the in the myasthenia gravis, what happens, the blocking antibody or to this particular receptor will be there, so that the acetylcholine cannot compete or cannot bind to that of the receptors and the muscle contraction will not occur. And the acetylcholine, which is freely available in the cleft, synaptic cleft, is destroyed by the acetylcholine esterase enzymes. So, because of this thing, the thymoma in the conditions like the thymoma, thymus cell, then affection, the beta cell, B cell activation and autoantibody production will be there, and the autoantibody antibody means the antibody developed against the tissue of the self and it is considered as foreign. Then the symptoms of the myasthenia gravis are like this: eye muscles drooping of one or both eyelids, it's also known as the ptosis. Ptosis means drooping of one or both eyelids. Here the drooping causes ptosis, and double vision, or it's also known as the diplopia. And face and throat muscles altered speaking, in case of the altered speaking, the tone and other thing of speaking changes, it's also known as the dysarthria, and difficulty in swallowing, dysphagia. And the problems of the chewing because of the muscles, especially the jaw muscles, are going to be affected. Limited facial expressions. So all this, the facial muscles are not under the control of your own. Then neck and limb muscles, weakness in arms, legs, neck and fingers. So many times you cannot, what you call as, the fold your own fingers if you are affected with the myasthenia gravis. And weakness in the chest muscles and sometimes occurs, and this service the myasthenia crisis may result, because whenever there is a chest muscle is affected, you cannot expand, the human cannot expand the chest small and big, so that the aeration of the lungs will not take place. That's known as the myasthenic crisis. So here you can see in this particular person, smoothing out of the forehead muscles and eyebrow will droop down, and drooping up of the corner of the mouth, especially just like paralysis. And we can see some more pictures. Here you can see that this is drooping or ptosis of the eyebrow. He or she cannot open the eyelids whenever such diseases are there. And smoothing up out the forehead, eyebrow will drop, and dropping up of the corner of the mouth, as explained earlier, will also be seen. And here the dropped head syndrome is known as, the initially the head is like this and the person cannot make his head straight, and sometimes this is the scoliosis may also happen. Many times the head cannot be rested on the shoulder. So these are all the clinical signs of the myasthenia gravis. And the pharmacological therapy is including of the anticholinergic drugs like neostigmine, pyridostigmine, corticosteroids like the prednisolone, and the immunosuppressant like azathioprine and cyclophosphamides. They are very commonly used. And neuromuscular junction, as usual, the acetylcholine receptor is occupied by the antibodies and the normal muscle contraction will be impaired. And the neostigmine and its congeners improve the skeletal muscles, especially skeletal muscles, and many times accumulate and act on the receptors over a longer area, whereas the treatment usually started with neostigmine 15 mg orally for 6 hourly time and frequently is then adjusted to obtain the optimum relief from the weakness. So the dosage requirement may fluctuate from time to time, and there are often unpredictable periods of remission and exacerbation. And pyridostigmine is an alternative which needs less frequent dosing. Then, if intolerable muscarinic effects are produced, atropine can be added to block them. So, atropine is a very specific antidote for the toxicity of all these agents. And the line of the treatment, especially in the myasthenia gravis, of course, it's explained, like the corticosteroids can also be used. The alternative line of the treatment apart from the polynomimetics. So, the corticosteroids afford considerable improvement in such causes by their immunosuppressive action. And removal of the antibodies by plasmapheresis means plasma exchange. So, all these antibodies are removed and another plasma is given. And another therapeutic approach. So, here it's a dramatic release if obtained, but it is very, very short-lived and can be the thymectomy means removal of the thymus is effective in a majority of the cases, and it produces gradual improvement, then complete remission has been obtained. That means one of the very effective treatment for the myasthenia gravis. And myasthenia crisis is characterized by acute weakness of the respiratory muscles as explained earlier, and this is managed by tracheal intubation. This is a very emergency situation. Of course, the tracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation is also done. And here you can see that especially in case of myasthenia gravis, the acetylcholine receptor or nicotinic type of the receptors occupied by the bad antibody acetylcholine receptor is occupied. Then this infusion of the IVIG causes the means antibody against this antibody, so that it will have a good antibodies against the bad antibodies. That's why the receptor will regain. And here also we can see that autoantibody production in myasthenia gravis is another type of the receptor in which the B cell is converted to plasma cell, and the varieties of the antibodies against the antibodies are produced. Antibody production, and these are going to block with that of the nicotinic antibody receptors, and the suppression of the autoantibody production will be there. And especially in case of thymectomy is done, and especially in case of respiratory muscle paralysis, we can see that the thymus gland is totally amputated, so that the symptom will permanently disappear. And the diagnostic tests for myasthenia gravis, how do we can diagnose? Let's say the ameliorative test, initially adrofonium 2 mg is injected IV as a test dose. If nothing untoward happens, then the remaining 8 mg is injected after 30 to 60 seconds. And reversal of the weakness and short lasting improvement in the strength of the affected mucus occurs in the myasthenia gravis and not other the muscular dystrophies. And the provocative tests like the myasthenins are highly sensitive to D-tubocurarins, especially the persons who are suffering from myasthenia gravis are very sensitive to DTC. And 0.5 mg IV causes marked weakness, and then but it's ineffective for non-myasthenics. The test is a hazardous because the DTC is highly toxic, but one has to use it very, very carefully. And respiratory muscles may get paralyzed, and the test is better not performed. and the demonstration of anti-NR antibodies in plasma or muscle biopsy specimen is a more layer level test. So nowadays it is being used very commonly. And anticholinesterases, especially the anticholinesterase poisoning, we'll deal a very brief about the, anyway, we are going to learn the poisoning of these anticholinesterase agents, and extensively used, these agents are used extensively in the agriculture purpose as an insecticide. Accidental as well as the suicidal and homicidal poisoning is a very common, and local muscarinic manifestation at the site of the exposure occur immediately and are followed by complex systemic effects like muscarinic, nicotinic and central. All the three actions will be elicited, and symptoms of the OPC poisoning are irritation to the eye, lacrimation, salivation, sweating, copious tracheobronchial secretions, miosis, blurring up of the visions, and also the bronchospasm, breathlessness, howling, involuntary defecation and urination will occur. Especially these are very characteristic of the organophosphorus compound. There will be fall in BP, bradycardia and tachycardia, and cardiac arrhythmia and vascular collapse will occur. So the muscular fasciculations will be seen, weakness of the muscle, respiratory paralysis. It's a central effect as well as the peripheral, and irritability, disorientation, unsteadiness, tremor, ataxia, all these clinical signs will be seen in organophosphorus compounds or the anticholinesterase phosphorus. And death is generally due to the respiratory failure. Then the treatment of organophosphorus compounds are irreversible inhibitors of the acetylcholinesterases are termination of further exposure is number one. Fresh air, wash the skin and mucous membrane with soap and water, and also please do the gastric lavage and as per the need, especially in case of the dogs and humans this can be done, but it's very difficult to do in case of the large animals like ruminants. And maintain patent airway, positive pressure, respiration if it is falling, and supportive measures like maintain blood pressure, hydration, control of convulsions with judicious use of the diazepam can be used. And the specific antidotes for the treatment of organophosphorus compounds is atropine. Atropine is the only antidote for the naturally occurring sympathomimetic amine, the cholinomimetic amines, than the organophosphorus compounds. It is highly effective in counteracting muscarinic symptoms, but higher doses are required to antagonize central effect. It has not got any effect on the nicotinic type of the receptor, and it does never reverse the peripheral muscular paralysis, which is a nicotinic action. And all cases of anticholinesterase or carbamate or the OPC poisoning must be promptly given atropine 2 mg per kg. Please remember the dose of atropine in organophosphorus compounds, especially carbamates or OPCs, are given as 2 mg IV, repeated 10 minutes till dryness of the mouth or other signs of atropinization appear. That means you can give the atropine up to 200 mg per day in a day. That means the 2 mg IV initially, followed by every 10 minutes till 200 mg, and continued treatment with maintenance dose may be required for 1 to 2 weeks until the complete recovery of the animal, or many times the relapse may also occur. And the cholinesterase reactivators are there, which are going to activate the acetylcholinesterase enzyme, and these are known as the auxins, are used to restore neuromuscular transmission only in case of the OPC or anticholinesterase poisoning. The phosphorylated cholinesterases reacts very slowly or not at all with the water. And however, if reactive hydrogen species then form auxins, and the generic formula is RCH and NOH are provided. A reactivation occurs more than a million times faster. And the pyridoxime or 2-PAM has positively charged quaternary nitrogen, and it is attached to the anionic site of the enzyme, which remains unoccupied in the presence of OPC compounds. So pyridroxine is effective antidote to carbamate or anticholinesterase poisoning like the physostigmine, neostigmine, carbaryl and profoxifene. And because anionic site of the enzyme is not free to provide attachment to it, it is rather contraindicated in the carbamate poisoning, especially the 2-palm, it itself become poisonous. So because of not only does not reactivate carbamyl enzymes, it has got weak anticholinesterase of its own. That's why it is not indicated in case of the carbamate poisonings. And pyridroxine, or it's also known as 2-palm, it is slowly administered at a dose of 1 to 2 gram children, 20 to 40 milligram. The same can be used in case of the dogs. Another regimen is 30 milligram IV loading dose followed by 8 to 10 milligram per kg per hour and continuous infusion till recovery. And the pyridroxine causes more marked reactivation of the skeletal muscles than cholinesterase, than the autonomic sites, and not all at all in the central nervous system. And as the pyridroxine is not going to penetrate the blood-brain barrier, it is not useful in the CNS signs. The treatment should be started as early as possible within few hours before the enzyme, phosphorylated enzyme, gets aging. So once the time passes to greater extent, then it will never be reversed. That's called as the aging up of the enzyme. And doses may be repeated according to need. Maximum 12 gram in first 24 hours, lower doses according to the symptoms are continued till 1 to 2 weeks, because this OPC poisoning is not a simple poison. It is highly potent poisoning and causes irreversible inhibition of the cholinesterase enzyme. The use of enzymes in OPC poisoning is secondary to that of the atropine. First, always you have to administer atropine followed by 2-palm, because the receptors need to be first blocked, then the enzyme need to be activated. So there are other enzymes like the obedoxime, more potent than pyridroxine, and diacetyl monoxime or DIAM. It's also there other than the pyridroxine, but the pyridroxine is very, very commonly used. And here you can see that pyridroxine iodide injection, it's available as 500 milligram, because when you become the veterinarians or the practitioners or the medicos, you need to use these drugs very repeatedly, because many times the homicides and suicides are 90% are due to the consumption of organophosphorus pesticides. So this is an antidote against organophosphorus poisoning, and the 500 milligram is available in 20 ml ampule is available, and the cost is about 175 rupees. And the palm injection is also, there are 2 ampules of 2-palm is available, 20 ml each, and it will be sufficient to treat a adult human being. And that's end of the cholinergic drugs, especially used in case of the varieties of disorder, especially the, what you call as the Alzheimer's disease, the OPC poisoning, and many more we have dealt. And in the next class, we will deal about the cholinergic agents and the other drugs. So,